Come on, high five somebody next door to you. Say, it's good to be in church this morning. All right, can you start the clock there for me now? Wow, what a week. Hasn't it been a big week? Wow, we're talking about seven big weeks, but I think this week was a big week. We were down at the coast trying to get a break, and so we missed the flooding here in Gauteng. Saw all the pictures. How many of you, anybody got caught in that? Close? There's one, two. Wow. So we thank the Lord for his protection. It's good to have the rain, isn't it? Great. It really is. But what about that landslide victory of Trump in the States? So some people are happy, some people are sad, some people, I mean, goodness me, Facebook has been alive and this and that and, oh, okay, I'm not taking sides or whatever, but it's interesting to see what's going down there. You know what I think? I think God's setting us up. I really do. I tell you, those who are doom and gloom and the world's falling apart, I'm going, come on, God is in control. Nothing happens without his control. You know what? Come on, let's stop being negative. Let's stop hashtag fall down this thing. None. You know, come on. Let's see the kingdom of God come in abundance and great power. So, hey, what about the Proteas? They're on top, down under. Bafana, Bafana won. Come on. Looks like we may make a World Cup, maybe. Yeah. Sorry about you rugby guys. Big weekend for sport, but we shh about the rugby. Hey. What happened about the red? Are we happy? Okay, who are the English in here? Any English? Okay, we'll see you afterwards. Oh, jeepers. Here we go. So this is the last week of our series, Seven Big Weeks. We have camped around a scripture that God revealed to us and really is, for me, has become something of a verse that I just keep going back to and back to. It's like a magnet drawing me to this, is that this Revelation chapter 5, it says, worthy is the Lamb that was slain. This is of Jesus. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive. And we see seven things. We see worthy to receive power, wealth, wisdom, might or strength, honor, glory, blessings. You've learned it. And it's brilliant. And I believe that God is restoring the fullness of Christ back into the church. Not sort of back in, but he's wanting, I believe, the desire, the purpose of the church is to see Christ fully expressed in this world. For the church to fully express Christ, to fully, so that the world would see Christ in the church. I believe that God's desire is for people to be flocking to the church, not mocking the church. And how often are we embarrassed about what people are saying? And there are some things that I don't want to be, I mean, I'm happy to be embarrassed about. We won't compromise. But many of the things, I'm going, God, I believe that there is coming a change, and God is wanting to restore more power, more wealth, more wisdom, more strength, more honor, more glory, and more blessing to the church, so that the church would fully express, or that Christ will be fully expressed here in this world. There's two things I believe that Ephesians teaches us about the church. Paul, this great church builder, master builder of the early church, wrote a lot of that of the New Testament. When he talks about the church in the book of Ephesians is really one of the kind of manuals of the church. He says two things. One is that it's for the church to express or to have Christ fully expressed in the world through the church. And then in Ephesians chapter 3, he says, it's also the purpose of the church to display the manifold wisdom of God to the powers and principalities of darkness. And God just loves to show off his church. The church is glorious. I love the church. I don't want to criticize the church. The church is the body of Christ here on earth. The church is the family of God. The church is glorious. The church should be powerful. The church should be wealthy. The church should be full of wisdom. The church should be full of strength and might. The church should be full of honor and value. The church should be full of the presence of God. The church should be full of the blessing of God. Come on. At least my wife is egging me on. The wife of my youth, 32 years this last week. And all glory and honor goes to her, not me, I tell you that. But here we go. I believe, and this has been the big idea of these 7 weeks, is that God is restoring to us and restoring to the church. As we turn to Him, He would restore the fullness of Christ to us so that He can pour out the fullness of His Holy Spirit upon us so that all men will call upon the name of the Lord. Our target is to see those who are far from God encounter this abundant life that Jesus brings and gives. It's too good to keep it in these four walls. It's too good just to enjoy it ourselves. It's too good to dam it up. And God wants us to have more blessing than before. But I want to say this, is that I believe that God wants us to be more of a channel of His blessing than to receive His blessing. Uh-oh. You see, the way of man, the problem, when you see the word blessing in Scripture, it is that the greater blesses the lesser. That's the way Scripture looks at it, is that the blesser is the greater to the lesser. The blesser is God, and He gives blessing to His people. But the problem is that what sin did is that when we receive the blessing of God, we want to keep it for ourselves. In fact, we even think that we are the blessing and the blesser. And when God gives me something and I have something and I share it with you and I go, have this blessing, I think, well, I'm the blesser. It's true. Remember that illustration I told you about, the extender, the Wi-Fi extender that I bought in America. If you weren't here, I used this illustration a few months ago. And I bought this very expensive Apple product overseas many years ago. I thought it was a Wi-Fi router. When I got back to South Africa, I actually discovered that it was a Wi-Fi extender. It didn't create the Wi-Fi in my house. It just took Wi-Fi and extended it. And I didn't know what the purpose of that was when I bought it, but now it's a very expensive paperweight on my desk and a very good reminder to me that I'm not the source, but I'm just the extender of the source. And you see, God didn't create us as the source. God didn't create us to be the blesser. He created us to be a channel of the blessing. He created us to take the blessing received from God and to give it on. Genesis 1:28 is a verse that has profoundly changed my life. It's because this verse is a verse that helps us understand the purpose of God for every one of us. And God comes to mankind as He's created them, the pinnacle of His creation, Adam and Eve, and He says to them in a blessing, and He says, and God blessed them. And this was the blessing. He didn't give them a Range Rover. He didn't give them a house. He didn't give them stuff. He gave them the ability to do that, to create that. And the blessing of God is that they would be fruitful. They would be able to multiply their fruitfulness, that they would have and become fill the earth and become a community of communities, and take the rule and reign of God into all the earth. This is the purpose of God. You see, when I understood that my purpose and is not to be a business owner, my purpose is not to be a preacher, my purpose is not to be an accountant, or your purpose is not to be a doctor or a teacher, that's a career. Your purpose and our purpose is to take the rule and reign of God to the ends of the earth. That's way bigger than what we normally think of, is it? What's my purpose in life? I can tell you, it's very simple. Your purpose in life is to take the rule and reign of God into all the nations of the world. That's the blessing of God. But what happened is sin came in, and then we dam up the blessings. And when stuff comes, we go, woo, this is for me. Woo. And then I accumulate as much as I can, and I look as wealthy as I can, and I look as blessed as I can, and I have as much as I can, so that when people come, that I bless them, and they think I'm the blesser and the blessing. Come on, I'm like that. I don't know about you. And I believe that God wants to give us a greater revelation that we're not called to be the blesser, but we're called to be a channel of the blessing. That's very difficult for me. It's such a difficult thing to do. I tell you that if you are a Christ follower here this morning, the strategy of the enemy is to cause us to crave the blessing, not the blesser. Our sinful nature craves the blessing, the stuff, instead of the one who gives it. That's our bias. If you're not a Christ follower here this morning, the thing is that you are craving something that you can't get hold of right now. But the good news is that this morning, I believe that you would find the true and the better blessing. You see, the enemy wants to hoodwink us that into believing that we are the blessing and not the channel of the blessing. And we become like little kids with a new toy. Have you seen that? Mine, mine, mine. One of the things I've realized mostly in the 7 weeks is that God wants to give us a greater revelation of what we have, not what we don't have or what we so much are craving for. Our desire for blessings determines our behavior. And this has been deeply challenging for me because as I look and desire some of the blessings of God, the stuff, it can so easily determine my behavior. And I begin to do things that I shouldn't do to get what I shouldn't have. There's this great story in the Bible, Jacob and Esau. And it's found in Genesis chapter 25. I think you know they were twins born. Esau was born first, Jacob afterwards. So Esau was the firstborn. Now in that culture, what that meant was the firstborn got a double portion of the inheritance or a double portion of the blessing from the father. So the firstborn son would get double what the other or second or third sons would get. So in this case, there was only two. So what it meant was that Esau would get 2/3 and Jacob only got 1/3. Okay, that's how it worked. There wasn't equality in that day in terms of every child gets equal. The firstborn son got double what the other got. Okay, so two sons meant they got 2/3. Jacob was only going to get 1/3. And you know, Jacob wasn't happy with that. He wasn't happy with the fact that his older brother was going to get double what he got. And so one day, of course, Jacob was a master chef, and he was in the kitchen, and he was having a master class with a pot of stew. Now, I don't know how stew can taste good, but anyway, he was in there with a master chef, and his brother Esau comes in from the field, smells this. He goes, oh, I want that. All right? Now, right in that moment, things were going on. Esau wanted a pot of stew and was willing to sell his birthright, his double portion, the 2/3, to give it to Jacob. He was willing to do that for a pot of stew. Jacob was willing to take it, and he was manipulating and doing it. And so he bought it. He stole the birthright of his brother, and now he had 100%. The problem was he had to get his father to actually convey and to give it to him. And he knew his father wouldn't do that. And so when it came to that time, when his father was now blind and was about to give over his inheritance, him and his mother, Jacob and his mother, had to hatch a plan and manipulate and become someone he was not to get something that he shouldn't have. And so, because Esau was hairy, he put on, you know, some hair, and he put on the smell of Esau, and he went in, and he disguised himself, and he stole the birthright, and he manipulated to get the blessing. And he thought, now I've got it, all of it. The problem was, he didn't bank on his brother wanting to kill him. And in an instant, he had nothing and had to run away for his life. And you see, what happened then is the story of how God takes Jacob into a foreign land and helps him understand the fact that you can't steal the blessing. You can't become someone or do something to get the blessing. You have to receive it from God. In fact, many years later, and you can read the story of Jacob, as even when God brought him back to the land and he wrestled for the blessing of God and he walked away there with a limp. And friends, how often and I look back in my life and see how stuff and how things and how I've dammed up the blessing of God and how I've become in thinking that I am the source and the blessing. And God has had to break that and take me on a journey to understand and still that we are just a channel of the blessing of God. You see, instant gratification can cost you your inheritance. And I want to say, young people, that an instant gratification can cost you the inheritance. An instant gratification can cost you the person that God really has set aside for you. One night can destroy it all. The good news is though, if that has happened, that God can restore it. And he wants to restore it. Maybe painful, and maybe you're going to go through some difficult times. But it's worth it. And even though you may come out with a limp, and you go, why do you limp? And you go, because I wrestled with God, but he blessed me. And the thing is, friends, is that when I go back, and I'm sure you too, as if you've been a follower of Christ for some time, you'll go back to those times where you've wanted something, you've tried to become someone that you are not to get something that you should not have. And even though God may want to give it to you, he doesn't want to give it to you the way that you want it. But to realize it and to put it aside and then wait for God to give it to you, that is not an easy process. But friends, I want to tell you, you may walk away with the limp, but you'll walk away with the blessing of God, knowing that you're a channel, not the blesser or the blessing. I believe that God wants to restore that. I was reading this verse as I was studying the word blessing. In Romans chapter 15 and verse 29, it says, I know that I have come to you. This is Paul. He's writing to this church in Rome. And he says, I know that when I come to you, he's telling them that he's going to come. He says that when I come to you, I will come in the fullness of the blessing of Christ. When I read that, and this is the first time in the New Testament that that word blessing appears, as in Revelation 5, the same word. The fullness of the blessing of Christ. It has deeply challenged me because I've begun to think is that even this morning as I was praying and contemplating this very verse and coming knowing that I'm going to stand here and I got to ask myself this question, and whether it was me, the enemy, or the Holy Spirit, but what was happening in me this morning was, am I coming here this morning in the fullness of the blessing of Christ? Now, that word fullness is a word in Greek that was used, it's actually a nautical term, it was used of a vessel, a ship. When a ship had all its cargo, all its crew, all its passengers, when it was full and ready to sail, they would say it's reached its fullness. It's ready, can go. So Paul says, when I come to you, I'm going to come in the fullness of Christ's blessing. And I go, Lord, I don't know if you had to come and start looking down in my vessel. And I began to walk down the corridors of my vessel, you know, my life. And there's a couple of doors and down in the cavities, down where the cargo should be. And I'm going, you don't want to go in there. It's like, you know, if Jesus is kind of the captain of the boat, my captain. And he goes, okay, let's go and inspect the vessel, Craig. No, you don't want to do it. It's full. It's full. It's full. Don't worry. Let's sail. Let's go. Let's go. No, 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 no. Let's just go check. Let's go check. Oh, Lord, Okay, come. Okay, let's go to this room. Have a look here. This is my voyage. This is where I've been. Look what I've done. Look how many people, my family. He says, no, I know that. Let's just go to another room. So why is it dark in here? No, Lord, I a lot of junk here. I want to forgive that person. That's when I got hurt. So, you know. Okay, let's go to another room. No, Lord, this is my baggage. I like this room, but you're not allowed in here. This is where I come to just like, you know. This is my thoughts, and you're not allowed in there, Lord. Is my vessel full? I think there's a cry in the heart of God for us to understand and to know that He's longing for His church to have the fullness of Christ in her. Two weeks ago, we looked at the scripture in Ephesians chapter 1, and I want to look at it again because right here, if you're a follower of Christ, I want to tell you what you already have. You see, the problem is the enemy wants to deceive us into thinking we don't have. And soon as we think we don't have, we will then crave the blessing instead of being a channel of the blessing. And I believe that as we sing that song, and it's a new song this morning, Let There Be Light. And you may be going, oh, Craig, another new song. Friends, I want to tell you, we're going to sing a lot of new songs in heaven. Get used to it now. We are going to sing a new song in heaven. But guys, the thing about new song is it challenges our hearts, and that's why we don't like it. And in that song, it talks about that let there be light. Let light come into the darkness of my corridors, of this vessel, my soul. Let there come an understanding and a revelation of what I have in Christ, not what I don't have in stuff. And so if you're a Christ follower, I want to tell you what you have so that we can be built up today. If you're not a Christ follower and you're here this morning, I want to tell you what you could have. And I believe that what you really are desiring to have. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, it says, you know what? This whole sentence, all that I'm going to read here is one sentence in the Greek. So it's like, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ who blessed us. I already did a thing. In Christ with every special blessing in heavenly places, even as He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and blameless before Him in love, predestined us to the adoption of sons through Jesus Christ. Okay. I don't know how the Greeks do it. Because we have got commas and full stops. They just have one sentence. So I don't know how it works. Maybe if you're Greek, you can come and help me. But anyway, we'll read it like with full stops and commas, all right? But this is so important. This is all one thought, friends, okay? This is what Paul says. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us. Say has blessed us. Past tense. Past. Has. Has. Say has. You see, that's got to get down. Has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Come on. I'm trusting the Holy Spirit now will bring and uncover some revelation to us this morning. You see, it's a spiritual blessing, not a material blessing. It's in the spiritual, it's in the heavenly places. Now, that doesn't mean like, oh, it's so far away. It's in the heavens. I can't. No. It just means it's not a material thing. You can't. Why? Because God doesn't. Remember the blessing of God to Adam and Eve was not a material blessing, but a spiritual blessing. An ability to be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, and bring the rule and reign and the dominion of God into all the earth. We have been blessed with that same blessing. It is a spiritual blessing. We're not to crave the material blessings. We are to be a channel of the true and better blessings of Jesus. Even as He chose us. Now, this is what He has done. Do you know that God chose you? You may think, oh, I chose God. When did you choose God? No, God chose you, and He chose you before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before Him. The thing is, He knew that we would never be able to be sinless. He knew that mankind would fall. He knew that. And so before the foundations of the world, he chose us to be blameless and holy and to stand before him. And how are we going to stand before a holy God when we are unholy? Here it is. In love, he predestined us as adoption, as sons, daughters, as to be the children through Jesus Christ. Friends, you know that we've been adopted into the family of God? You know, the problem is, I don't know about you, but sometimes I think I live a bit like the neighbor of the rich people in the neighborhood. You know those people in the neighborhood that they've just got this big house, big car, got all the money, you know, the kids always go there. I remember growing up when I was a teenager, I remember TV coming to South Africa. How many in the house can remember TV coming to South Africa? Come on, there are a few of us here, isn't it? All right, 1976, I think it was, or somewhere around there. Now, my parents, whether I can't remember, they afforded it, couldn't do whatever it is, but we had to go to the neighbors because they were blessed. They had everything. Had a big house, had a big the TV, they had a color TV. We went there. And you know what? Somehow we live, oh, they blessed, they the neighbors. Do you know that we have been adopted into the family of God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the savior of the world, the one who owns everything. Our father is the blesser. I think, yeah, there should be a lot more, yeah. Not, you know, my concern is, and it's for me too, because I realize that I live like, oh God, father, you know, you bless that person and not me. And it's not about stuff, friends. You see, the kingdom of God is an inside-out kingdom, not an outside-in. And the problem is, when we, as our natural bias of sinners, is that our bias is to look at the stuff we have to give us our significance or our emotional well-being. So when I have a nice Range Rover, when I have a nice house, when I have a good job, when I've got all the degrees, when I've got that, look at me. Now, I'm not saying those things are wrong. Absolutely not. I believe God wants to give it. When the thing is it giving you significance or are you taking those things and being a channel of blessing? Remember, the whole of our series that we went through, Sermon on the Mount, remember, the whole thing that Jesus was talking about there was what? Doesn't matter what happens on the outside. It's what's happening on the inside. Man, I tell you what, I want the church to be more wealthy than the world. I believe that we should have the Warren Buffetts in the kingdom of God. Honestly, I do. I believe that God is going to bring in significant people with wealth and wisdom, power, authority, understanding that is going to be a channel for God's blessing. But it comes from the inside out. And I believe that we need to help turn that around. Let's not live like poor neighbors when we are adopted as sons and daughters in the household of God. According to the purpose of his will. Now, here he goes. This is giving us the purpose. To the praise of his glorious grace, which he has blessed us in the beloved. We are blessed in Christ. Say, in Christ. There we go. In him, we have, in Christ, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will. I want to tell you, God doesn't hide things from us. He hides things for us, and he will reveal the mystery of his will for you, for me, according to his purpose which he set forth in Christ. My purpose, your purpose, our purpose is set forth in Christ. Friends, we've got to get away that my purpose in this life is to make money or my purpose is to do that. My purpose, our purpose is only found in Christ. We are called, we have a career, we have strength, we have these things, we can abilities, we've got to do things, I get it, but friends, our purpose is in Christ. As a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. That's when God is working to a plan. That's why God is setting this thing up. You think that God is shaken by Trump? or by America or by whatever. Don't worry about those things. Let's pray. Let's ask God. You know what? We've got more trouble in our nation. Let's get on our knees and pray that God would bring about his will in our nation, in our day. In him we have obtained an inheritance. In Christ we've obtained an inheritance. Having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were first to hope in Christ, the Jews, might be the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard of the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, for us, the Gentiles, believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession to the praise of his glory. Friends, if we don't believe this, if we believe in the lies of the enemy, we come under a curse, not under a blessing. Revelation uncovers the truth, brings us into blessing. A couple of things quickly that I'm going to share with us, and then we'll be ready to respond to him. Number one, God's blessing is grounded in his grace. I want us to understand that the blessing of God that comes to us is grounded in his grace, not in our works, not in our effort, not in our holiness, not in anything that we've done or could do. It comes because of his grace, his unmerited favor, and that he gives us what we don't deserve. And what we do deserve, he doesn't give us. That's because of his grace. When we live in this gospel, we will be a channel of his blessing. When we understand that we don't receive blessing because of our goodness, we don't get the stuff that we have. The stuff that you have, and the material blessing you have is no indication of your spiritual blessing. Let me just equate that quickly. So we're all on the same level. Because you don't look at the rich and say, "Woo, man, they blessed." No, the true blessing of God is salvation by grace. It's Christ is the blessing. Yes? Material blessing is no indication. Can be, and we should have some material blessing. But the problem is, if you don't have material blessing, that does not mean you're not blessed. Please do not look at the material blessings to see if you are blessed or not. Because if they're taken away, what's going to happen? The true blessing is that we gain Christ. And the gospel is we get it because of God's grace. Oh, it's amazing. You see, after me going down the corridors of my vessel and going, "God, I don't want you to go in there, and I'm not worthy. I don't have the fullness of God." This is what God took me through. He says, as I was going through this, he said, "You have the fullness of blessing." And it was like the Holy Spirit took me on a tour of my vessel this morning and said, I'd open the door. No, you don't want to go in there. He says, "What's the problem in here? All looks fine. But I don't see anything. I just see Jesus." "What?" "Yeah. What about, you can't go there. That's my thought." "What's the problem here?" "I just see Jesus." You see, when we live and understand that we will never be good enough to have the fullness of God. We'll never be perfect enough. We are sinners saved by grace. And our shortcomings, yes, it's not a license to go and do whatever we want, but it is the gospel of Jesus Christ that says, "In Christ I am blessed, and because of his blood I am redeemed and restored. I'm adopted as his son, and there's nothing I can do to make him love me more, and there's nothing I cannot do to make him love me any less." And when he goes into the corridors of my very dark life, he just sees Jesus. Now that's blessing. God's blessing provides a purpose for my life. You see, and I've shared a little bit, so I'm going to just go quickly here. God's blessing gives me my purpose. It's in Christ. You're part of a bigger plan. You have a purpose. God's purpose, God's blessing establishes your identity or our identity. Because of the blessing of God to us, It establishes our identity. He chose us. Let's not live like poor neighbors, but let's live in the household of God, knowing that our Father is the blesser and we are a channel of His blessings. I hope this is liberating for you this morning. And God's blessings are experienced through His Spirit. Friends, I love this verse. It has been one that I'm meditating on more and more. 1 Corinthians 2 verse 12 says this: "Now we have received not the spirit of the world." Friends, we have not received the spirit of the world, but we have received the Spirit who is from God, that we might understand the things freely given to us by God. Oh, Holy Spirit, would you come and would you reveal to us this morning the things that you've freely given to us? That you've given us, you've chosen us, you've predestined us, you've adopted us into your family. Would you show us just the richness and the lavishness of your grace? Would you come and help us understand the greater, the enormous purpose to which you've called, that infinite purpose we can't even seem to grapple or grasp it. But would you give us a revelation this morning? I know you're probably getting there and say, "Okay, Craig, that's it. I get it. Now I want it. How many of you want it?" You're going, "Yes." Have you heard that song that says, "When the praises go up, the blessing comes down"? You heard that song? It says, "When the praises go up, the blessings come down. Praise until your situation turns around." You know that song? You don't know that song? Come on, there it is. Let's go. Okay, that went. What happened to our music? Cue the music. Okay, it didn't happen. Man, I had a great song.
Praise Him.
It took us a little while. So the words of that is, praise Him till the blessings come down. Praise Him till your situation turns around. Now, there's something great about that. Something I really like about that is that we need to praise Him till our situation turns around. But there's something that's not really right about that. Because we don't praise Him till the blessings come down. Why? Because the blessing already came down. And the blessing is Jesus. You see, what happened actually was that Jesus became someone He was not to give us something that we could not get. Jesus became sin so that we, the sinners, could get redeemed, set free. In Galatians chapter 3, it says, "Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming the curse for us. For it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree.' So that in Christ Jesus, the blessing of Abraham might come to us, the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promised Spirit through faith." You see, Jacob had to become someone he was not to get the blessing that he should not get. Jesus became something he was not to give us the blessing that we could not get. Ah, there's the gospel right there. For our sake, He has made us. For our sake, He made Him to be sin, who knew no sin. This is Jesus. So that in Him, we might become the righteousness of God. When we accept this and know this through His Spirit, it doesn't matter what material blessings you have or don't have. This is when we are truly blessed. We don't praise because we want the blessing. We praise because we have the blessing. Man, I love that. We don't praise because we want the blessing. We praise because we have the blessing. And this is the ultimate aim of God, is that when we praise Him because of what we have, the blessing of God, it causes other people to get saved, to hear God, the gospel. They go, "What is this?" And you go, "Man, You shouldn't be praying, but I'm praying. What have you got? I've got the blessing of God. But you don't have stuff. You don't have this. You don't. You don't. No, no. I've got Jesus. And people say, I want what you got. I don't care about the cars and the houses and this and the material things. I want that internal peace. I want the purpose to come to my life. I want to know that my life is going to be lived with purpose and significance. I want to know that the Creator who created me has called me. And I'm not a mistake. But that you chose me before the foundations of the earth. There's a cry in the world, friends. We don't praise Him for what we want. We praise Him for who we have. His name is Jesus. And people begin to call upon the name of the Lord. When we turn to Him, He'll restore to us to be a channel of His blessing. The pouring out of the Holy Spirit will come and people will begin to call on the name of the Lord. We praise, people get saved, they begin to praise God. The blessing is a channel. Why? So that all nations, even Japan, would hear, put their faith in, trust in. Don't know about you this morning, let's just stand this morning. I want to give you an opportunity. You may be here this morning and you've never realized that you're not in the family of God. You live like a neighbor. You want to be in the household of God, and you've not known how. I want to tell you, it comes through this one name, one man, and His name is Jesus. He is the Son of God, and He came down, the blessing of God, to become what we were so that we could become what He is. Son of the living God, adopted as family. If you want to do that this morning, you want to put your faith and belief in God, you want to say, Craig, I want to be adopted into the family of God. I want to give you that opportunity this morning. Maybe with just our heads bowed in a moment of contemplation, and God's speaking to you, and you know there's like a beating on your heart. And God is saying, I've chosen you. I've chosen you. I want you. I created you. I've destined you to be great in the kingdom of God. You want to choose Him now. You want to go, God, I want that. I want to be adopted. I'm going to count to three and I'm going to ask you to lift your hand as a declaration in your heart to say, God, I'm tired of my life. I want you. I want you to be adopted. I mean, you may not fully know and understand, but you know God is doing something in your life this morning. And I want to give you this opportunity to respond to Him.